Hi, this is Raphael Mutch, the creator of Cobalt Strike. And in this video, I'm going to do a Cobalt Strike user's introduction to Core Impact. Core Impact is a penetration testing tool and exploit framework that dates back to 1998. I'm doing a video on it because Core Impact and Cobalt Strike are part of the same company. We're part of Help Systems, and my team and the Core Impact team, we work pretty closely together. Or I should say we do now. We're part of the same company, right? And when this video comes out, you'll see that we have a few videos and some information on Cobalt Strike and Core Impact interoperability. And I thought it would be very helpful for those of you who are Cobalt Strike users who haven't used Core Impact to learn a little bit about the tool from me, because you know, we speak the same language, right? And so that's my goal, introduce you to the tool. So when I think about Core Impact, I very much think of Core Impact as having the same place in our arsenal as Metasploit and Armitage did. Core Impact, of course, is a post-exploitation agent, the impact agent for multiple operating systems, a collection of modules to exploit a target, and a graphical interface and some automation for both launching modules, keeping track of data, and conducting post-exploitation on a target. So let's go ahead and dig into it. First thing I want to say, this is the welcome screen you'll see when you start the product. And I want to point out that we release an update of Core Impact a couple times a year now. So we are now on a cadence of getting an update out. I think we're aiming for once a quarter. And in between those releases, we are releasing modules. We're not just having you wait till the next release to get the next great module. So we are constantly looking at vulnerabilities, weaponizing those once they're QA'd and certified via a team for that exact purpose. We actually have our own QA team devoted solely to module and exploit QA. But once those are pushed out, they're going to show up here in this screen, in this table here. And this is actually an engineering build. That's why you don't see a whole collection of modules. But if you hit install pending updates, your impact will have the latest and greatest that we have to offer. And we are constantly pushing out new modules and updating and improving existing ones. So you can see here, we pushed out about 7 modules in November, 10 in September. And that's the tempo we go at. We do have a prioritization scheme to make sure that we're putting our time and effort into things that are going to be the most relevant to you. All right, let's go ahead and jump into an engagement, take a look at the kind of an attack chain with the tool and just get oriented to it. I'm going to go to new workspace, blank workspace, and we're going to call this demo 3. We're going to put in my password, which is password. And this is just a workspace for each engagement to keep the data separate. So here we are in Core Impact. One thing I'll point out, if you go to view layouts, you can change the layouts. I'm using classic right now. You can also reorganize the interface to your liking if you wish, and actually just drag modules around the interface and really change things around that way. So that's a thing you can do. And you know, it's just kind of fun to play around with that if you like. But for this demo, we're going to use the classic layout. So let me orient you a little bit to the interface. Executed modules are the individual modules that as we run, they will show here. And you can click on that module. And when you do, it will update this window here, the module output. So you'll see module output, which is usually going to be a rich HTML representation of the findings of that module or whatever information it has to relate to you. Module log will be more of just the raw output, like just random stuff, sometimes stuff that's very useful, but be used to flipping back and forth between these two to see what happened with that module. And module parameters will relay to you how the module was configured when it was run. And you can click through any module you've run and see all this information at any time. Quick information, this is going to be a way to see information about a highlighted module. So if I click on a module, for example, if we click on package and register agent, all the meta information for the module will show here. You can click through these gray things just to see more information about the module. And that applies, of course, to our exploits as well. In the middle here is very much like it is the view. It's your main situational awareness view in the tool. It shows hosts and agents. So what you always see is a host, and you will see an agent or multiple agents underneath it. And above it is a tool to actually change what is in the view down here. So that's what's going on here. So you actually have a tree to organize everything. So if you click identities, this is like going to view credentials in Cobalt Strike or even Armitage. Host, this is where you get to see your targets. And you can even configure special, they call them search folders, but you can actually create criteria to quickly show what you want to see. So if you like add criteria for an agent, hit add, and you can say, show me somewhere where we've got an agent that's connected. And there you go, you've got all your connected agents. You can give that criteria a name, it'll show up in that search. And you can at any time click on that and narrow what you're seeing in Core Impact. So this is a way to quickly slice and dice the targets and host view, which are or targets and sessions, which is combined in Core Impact to what you want. So that's what's going on up here and how that interacts with what's here. All right, to the left, we have the RPT. This is your rapid penetration testing wizards. These are really, that's what they are. They are wizards for different phases of the engagement. And they're automation meant to help you with information gathering and reconnaissance. You can think of this as being your classic scanning targets and finding information. Attack and penetration, you can think of as a smarter version of like what was Hail Mary in Armitage. Local information gathering is to loot the system. So you could think of it as simultaneously a survey tool and a credential harvester. Privilege escalation is a wizard to help you find something that may help you escalate privileges. I really personally still find value in just trying out modules based on what I know about the target. But privilege escalation, you can think of this as almost being like a Hail Mary for privilege escalation. The other thing I want to point out is that impact is organized by attack surfaces. And we think of these internally as personalities in the tool. So here we've got network, and you can see we've got the network wizards, right? And if I come over here, we've got the network modules. If I click client side, I want to show you something. It all changes. We have different modules, and we have different wizards. If I click web, same thing, it changes. We have different wizards, and we have different modules. One thing I really want to point out to you, when you're searching for modules in the module browser, and we get to that by clicking on modules down here, when you're searching for modules, be sure to like look at all these, all three of these attack surfaces, especially network and web, because some things that exploit an application and are turnkey way to get access are under web. So don't ignore these attack surfaces or you might miss out on some of the capability in the tool. We are actually working to move some of the things that are just turnkey. You could think of them as network exploits, but they target a web application. We are working to identify some of those, get those moved over to network, but for now, just keep that in mind. All right, so we've got modules. Here's the module tree in Impact. Let me just kind of give you an idea of how to understand this, how to navigate it. I'm a big fan of just searching it. All right, so for example, if you want to see all the modules for 2020 CVEs, you can click the magnifying glass, search by CVE. But it's handy, I think, just search for 2020 and see what pops up. And a couple cool things you'll find here. You'll see that we are keeping up date on things I know that are relevant to me, like For example, SMB Ghost, that was a big privilege escalation that had come out earlier this year that was for an up-to-date Windows 10. You've got, if we search for 2019, you will see that a lot of things from 2019 that are interesting are there. So you've got, for example, Bluekeep. We have the a Bluekeep detector module. We do have an RCE exploit for it. And one thing to point out with that particular exploit, caveats apply, but you can click on the module and look through the meta information to kind of understand where the module might be interesting. So this one's actually XP Service Pack 3, x86. And this other Bluekeep exploit we have is for Windows 7 Professional 64-bit. So looking at the module meta information is helpful. You can right-click on a module, go to Edit, and see the source code to the module. So that's helpful. And it is the source. You can kind of see what's going on with that module and the comments if that information interests you. And the big standbys, what I'm basically trying to get across is that even though we've got our own prioritization scheme, if you kind of keep up on the things that are like, that's a really interesting exploit. Exploits to me are not a volume game. I really do think it is a quality game. The things that are pretty relevant and interesting, they're here. That's the main message I'm trying to get across to you. If we come over to web, search for 2020, one of them, the Microsoft Exchange validation key command injection exploit, that one was CVE-2020-0688. That's one where from a domain user context, you can go to control of an Exchange server, which is usually pretty juicy. So that's here. It's just under web because it happens to target a web application component that's part of Exchange. So the F5 Big IP one, that's a pretty important one. That's here. This one's not necessarily a difficult exploit, but it's here. I mean, it's important that it is here. And so we do have these things in the tool. And same thing, if you look at the client side tree, search for 2020, see what comes up, search for 2019. Again, see what comes up. And that's the client side tree. My main interest tends to be in the network and web trees because that's where the most interesting to me exploits are. You can navigate the tree as well. Just look at local here. That's our local local exploits, remote code execution. That's where the network exploits are. Again, searching for those is probably the way to go. Information gathering are our reconnaissance modules, and are also under local. That's the modules to loot a box. Again, pulling credential material, pulling information, stuff like that. So that's a little bit on the module tree. Again, I just wanted to kind of introduce you to and orient you to the tool, how to find things. I think to get the most out of Impact, it's important to be aware of a few key modules that are kind of go-tos for just entry points into your offense process. I'm going to talk about those in a moment. One last thing I want to point out about Impact that is very important is that Impact's offense model is completely agent-oriented. Impact does not launch exploits. It does not scan targets. It does not do anything from the Impact agent itself. Within the product's offense model, everything is always, always carried out through an agent. And to start you off, you always have a local agent because that is the first agent that everything you're doing is going to be sourced from. But as you start to compromise targets and get new agents, you can do set as source, and suddenly everything you're doing, every module you're launching, is now going to be having that activity occur from that newly selected source agent. And that is Impact's pivoting model. It's a bit different from what you might be used to in the Metasploit framework, where you create a routing table for your pivots. And it's a bit different from Cobalt Strike as well, because Cobalt Strike, while it is agent-oriented, Cobalt Strike is also very much a living on the land tool. Like Cobalt Strike Everything happens within the agent. Everything happens through a native Windows API. And Impact, everything is largely happening through Impacket, riding on top of a tweaked Python that is routing all the different calls that Impacket would normally make to whatever the currently selected agent is. So that's a little bit of what's going on there. And I know that's a lot of preamble, but you know me, I like to talk about this stuff before really kind of digging into it. For me, my entry point into the offense process is usually to start an agent on a target, okay? I'm a big assume breach person. A lot of my experiences have been cyber defense exercises where the red team is almost always assume breach. And so having a first agent is very important, or even being able to just export an agent and run it with another access I might have is important. And I want to show you the go-tos for that purpose. The first module I want you to be aware of, and I really think we should have like a huge button right here. It says serve agent and web server right at the top of the tool. But that is serve agent and web server. This is very much like Cobalt Strike's attacks web drive-by scripted web delivery. This is your module to stand up a web server with an artifact that you can download and run on a target. Very, very, very useful, very important module to be aware of. You will see that we can configure the architecture. We can configure the platform. I mentioned Impact is not Windows only. Cobalt Strike, yep, very Windows-centric. That is not the case of Impact. And in fact, our ability to give you a post-exploitation interface for Linux, Mac OS X, OpenBSD, FreeBSD, and Solaris, that's pretty important, I think. That's a pretty important piece of value in the tool. So we're going to do Windows to start us out, though, 64-bit. If we click on Web Server, we can change some things. Again, once you have agents in other places, you can stand up serve agent and web server from other Impact agents. That's no problem. Like, that's just native for this tool set. If you go to agent connection, this is where you configure how the agent will connect back to us. I always recommend using connect from target, which is reverse TCP. That's a reverse TCP connection. That is going to be the most performant agent in the tool. You can configure a specific agent to receive the connect back through. Again, pivoting, very natural in Impact. But we're just going to let it be our default source agent, which is localhost. We'll do 9090 for that. One other thing I'm going to do here is under advanced. I am, for this demo, I don't always do this, by the way, but for this demo, we're going to flip enable injection to true. And that is basically auto-migrate. And that's going to put us into a Microsoft-signed process after the agent first runs. The value of this step is that I'm going to do a UAC bypass in a little bit. And because it's an auto-elevated COM object, we have to be in a Microsoft process context. And so this is a shortcut to get there. All right, let's hit OK. And you can see, true to form, executed module right here. Green means it's still running. And if we go to module log, you can see everything is kind of setting up. And once it is set up, we will get the URL right here. So we just right click copy, put that in our clipboard. And like I said, very much like scripted web delivery in Cobalt Strike, except you're getting back an executable. Here we are on Windows 10. A couple things I want to emphasize. Because we're doing kind of an assume breach scenario, I did turn off real-time protection on Defender. I think it's important to disclose when I do that. And this is an up-to-date patch Windows 10 system. I mean, for especially like a modern enterprise, you're talking about at least the administrative networks. Those are always going to be to some baseline that are usually patched up-to-date systems. And so that's why I'm showing it to you this way here. Of course, once you start pivoting in a little bit further, things can change. But just a moment ago, I heard a WAV file play, and it's that very famous WAV file of new agent deployed. And that's an indicator from Core Impact that indeed we have compromised the system. We now have a new agent. So if we come over here to Core Impact, you can see that the external IP of where we saw the connection come from is showing up here, but also the internal IP of the system. If we expand that little tree, we can see a yellow flash next to our agent. So the yellow flash means medium or low integrity context. Blue means a high integrity context. So great, we have our first agent on our box, and that was via serve agent and web server. Very handy. The other one I want to make you aware of is package and register agent. This is like attacks packages, Windows executable S, stageless, and Cobalt Strike. Same thing, this lets you export a binary for a different platform. So if we did Linux, we could choose to give ourselves an executable or position independent code, choose the architecture. Same thing for Windows. Give me back an executable, a DLL, or position independent code. And same thing, you can configure how the agent connects back to you and everything else. But no package and register agent, no serve agent web server. They're very important modules. They are go-tos when using this tool set. All right, so we have an agent. What can we do with it? Well, if we right-click, I like to say that a agent really has to give you three things: upload, download, and execute. Back in the day, upload, download, execute meant exactly that. Upload a file, download a file, and run something using a command interpreter and get output back. Today, I would expand execute to say execute is a lot of things. It is at a base level, run a command in a command interpreter, get output back. But it is also your different weaponization strategies and the different things that are exposed to you for running things. Cobalt Strike gives you execute six ways to Sunday. We do it because it's a red team tool, and our goal is to push back on security operations and detection response strategies with the tool. And that happens to require that we have a lot of different strategies to execute various offense actions with a lot of control over that specific chain. Core Impact is very much a tool to look at attack surface, do reconnaissance on attack surface, and demonstrate the risk of an unpatched vulnerability, weak credentials, and demonstrate what you can get to from those things. And so there's not as big of an emphasis on stealthy execution of post-exploitation actions because that's not the purpose of the tool. That's not to say we as red teamers can't pull value from it, but I just want you to be aware of it. It's also helpful to understand some of the ideas in Impact and what it's giving you. So let me kind of give you a vignette. Years ago, I used to red team with this guy, Josh. Not going to give his last name because he's actually a pretty well-known entrepreneur. I know I've read about him and his various endeavors in the press a few times. But he and I have actually red teamed together a few times. And he had a very heavy systems administrator background as well. And Josh's style of red teaming was to say, give me a console. Let me RDP into a box. And make sure nobody gets on it. Just let me use it. And let me already be onto a box in blue space. And I'll just upload every tool I need. Give me PuTTY, give me PLINK, and every native Windows tool. And I will just do what I've got to do. Like, I can do it. Don't worry. And that, like, he was awesome. He was, like, he was quite valuable in an engagement. And I've worked many times with folks like Josh on a red team where they're just saying, give me an interface to do what I know how to do, controlling the system, and I'm ready to go. And Impact, I would say, is almost tailor-made for those folks, like in terms of what kind of post-exploitation experience it's trying to offer you. So for example, when I right-click and go to shell, I get back a shell. And everything in Impact, what it's trying to give me in its post-exploitation tools is something to really emulate how I might be using the tool locally, like if I was actually sitting in front of that system as a systems administrator. And so this is definitely a tool set where you want to kind of combined that I know how to control a system thinking with the different tools to boost what you can do that are available in Impact. If we go to PowerShell shell, we've got a PowerShell shell and I can do things through it. If we type pound help, we actually have some commands that are specific to Core Impact. Import file is like PowerShell import in Cobalt Strike, and import URL is a way of using a download cradle to bring a script into the tool. And you can bring different PowerShell scripts in and use their commandlets from this PowerShell window. And again, the intent is to give you an interface that feels familiar to sitting in front of the computer and just using it. We do have our file browser, Browse Files, and that's going to take a moment to come up because we're listing C Windows System 32, and that's quite a bit of data. But here we are. And again, the intent is to recreate that native experience for you and to let you have a sense of just sitting in front of the computer, upload, download files, kind of whatever you want to do. All right, so that's what's going on here. Nothing too crazy, just a file browser. I mentioned the pivoting model. Everything is based on setting an agent as source. And once you do that, everything is going to start happening through that agent. And that has implications. I want to point this out because I think this is very important in understanding Impact and really kind of getting value out of the tool. So when we set this agent as source, right, I want to show you something. When I launch, say, package and register agent, and I go to a target file and choose where to dump the output of this module, let me show you something. The save file browser that's going to come up in this case is actually a save file browser for the current source agent. So if we come to see users, that's Jim Stevens. This is a file browser for that compromised Windows system. So I can just navigate right to where I want to drop, right where I want to drop that generated executable or artifact right from the tool. So I don't need to save it locally and then just upload it to target. I can just choose where on the target to save it. And that's the philosophy of Impact, is to kind of make you feel like you are working with that source agent system when it is set that way. And that is something that's just fundamental to the tool. And that's why I'm spending the time talking about it. Couple other things. If we go to screenshot, this will give you a screenshot. One thing that's different about Impact versus Cobalt Strike, in Impact, getting a screenshot is a risk demonstration tool. It is saying, hey, here's proof I compromised this target. See? In Cobalt Strike, we weaponize screenshots. We make it so you don't take a screenshot. You take screenshots when the user is not idle over the course of days or weeks and browse through and annotate the interesting ones. And you're using that to further your engagement. But in Impact, the purpose of screenshots is just risk demonstration. It is to demonstrate that, hey, look, here's information we were able to, we had control of this system. So again, I point this out just so you can kind of understand the philosophy of the tools and where they provide value. So that's screenshots. We do have Mimikatz. So just be aware of that. All right, so I've covered some basic post-exploitation. The last one is Minishell. And Minishell is upload, download, execute. It's same across the different Impact agents. And not a lot here right now, but it is the basics. Over time, I hope this is something we expand to make it a little bit more like an Impact flavor, a beacon or interpreter, because that's exactly what this is. This is your kind of like native agent commands. Okay, so I'm taking through quite a bit here. So, oh yeah, show modules executed on this target. So if you want to just see different modules that were fired, you can do that as well, or even our recent post-exploitation modules. And I would ask you any questions if we were doing a video call, but this is a recording. So let's kind of move on a little bit. Within the RPT, you can do local information gathering to loot that target. You can do privilege escalation to see if there's something in Impact's repertoire to try to escalate privileges on that system. That's all well and good. Me, I'm a little bit old school. I like to, you know, just do a who am I whack all and see if, for example, UAC applies. And you could see here we are in a medium integrity context, but in the administrators group. So this is a perfect place to try out a UAC bypass attack. Let's take a look at that. Let's do UAC. And we do have one. Let's drag that onto the agent. Hit OK. And this is going to execute the core impact UAC bypass attack. I just had the new agent deployed. You can see the blue flash. And there we go. We've bypassed UAC on this patched and up-to-date Windows 10 system. I just point out as kind of a guardrails item, this agent needs to be in a Microsoft process context because this particular UAC bypass uses a elevated COM object. And those will not elevate in a, or auto-elevating COM object. They will not auto-elevate in a random update.exe. So same thing here, right? Like we can open up a shell and, you know, do a who am I whack all and see kind of our privileges and, you know, that we're in a high integrity context. That's fine. We can run Mimikatz. So if we just right click Mimikatz, that's something I think every time I get onto a box, I do. And what you will see is if we clear that filter up here, we will see Mimikatz. Here's the output in kind of an HTML-ish view. Module log is the same information. Another thing you'll notice is that the hashes were submitted to a password cracking service that we maintain at Core Security. That's CloudCypher. You have the option to opt into this when you install Impact. But if you're really paranoid and you're like, no way, I do not want hashes leaving my environment, perfectly understood. Again, I want to emphasize it's not a default, but just go to Tools, Options, and come to Core CloudCypher and just hit no. And you've opted out of submitting those creds for cracking. All right. Again, for us, I understand that we don't want our pen testing tools kind of communicating back to the mothership, and just flip that off. You're good. All right, so I'll actually just leave it off for me for now. So that's what's going on there. And again, that nice little HTML view. And again, if you click identities up here in this box, this is very much kind of like navigating to view credentials in Armitage. And you can see these different identities that we've harvested. So we've harvested, in this case, an NTLM hash. And we've got Kerberos tickets as well that we've harvested. The other thing that's really important to point out about Impact is because we are using Impacket, when we do pass the hash, we're not doing it the Cobalt Strike way of calling out into Mimikatz. We're doing it the Impacket way. So if you've got a password hash you want to fire, you can do so, and you can do so against an unprivileged agent in Core Impact. All you've got to do is, let me click over here, go back to host. All you got to do is kind of pick the agent you want to work from, in this case, agent zero, which is still set as source. And our lateral movement options are our install agent using SMBs, like basically like PSExec, install agent using WMI. And when you opt to run those against a target, we're actually going to do that in a little bit. We'll do some lateral movement. You can actually pick the target, and you can pick the identity that we've got in our credentials model, if you will, or we call them identities. Or you can just specify the information manually. So you have that option in this tool set. And again, because the offense model is different, you are using an Impacket here. Essentially, you don't have to be escalated on target. The other thing that's nice is where Cobalt Strike is doing everything on the target, there really isn't as much event visibility on the target because we're doing so much through Impacket and just tunneling it through our agent. Again, different offense model, different strengths. So I've talked about lateral movement. It'd be pretty cool to show you some lateral movement, actually. And I think first, before we start doing some lateral movement, let's actually do some target discovery. And there's a couple options here. We can do the RPT, which will kick off the cool little information gathering wizard. But before I do that, let me show you something that's not exposed in the RPT, and that's the Windows Domain Information Gathering Wizard. And the Windows Domain Information Gathering Wizard is, actually, I can just double click it. It's my source agent. This is a wizard, but what it'll do is collect information about that domain that that compromised system is on and query just a lot of information for us. And I'm actually going to just put the domain in, corp.acme.com. And we can configure like how we're going to probe targets using kind of one of the built-in identities, or basically having the agent kind of ask the system to do things on behalf with our on our behalf with our current token. One thing I'll point out is Cobalt Strike, because everything is done by manipulating your token and logon sessions, using native commands with an identity is very natural to Cobalt Strike, but that's not something you do through Impact, through Impacket and Core Impact as much. But again, each approach has their advantages and disadvantages, so it's nice to have both in your arsenal. So we are kind of kicking off this Windows Domain Information Gathering Wizard. And what you can see when you expand this is just a lot of different modules ran. And we can look through the different information recovered by each of these modules. So the different trusted domains, you can see we've got our power domain. You can see the different domain groups and the domain administrators, which we're not able to list from this particular context. Let's come over here. You can see the different domain machines, and that's the same as kind of doing the classic red team trick, whether we do it through the command line or a module, but my favorite is net group domain computers, whack domain. And that's the same thing kind of going on with the domain information gathering wizard here, is just to query those different machines. Cobalt Strike has the same thing. It's net computers and beacon. Again, just some kind of classic information to learn a little bit more about our environment. In Impact, the information gathering wizard, that's kind of your entry point to doing reconnaissance. We do have Agent Zero as our source agent already. I'm just going to hit next. I'm going to tell Core Impact to perform the information gathering on target IP addresses. We'll do IPv4. We actually have to put in the target range, which I know is 10, 10, 10. 0, WAC 24, hit next. And we're going to just do fast, kind of make this go through a quick demo. And what you can see is as the information gathering is going, that information is going to show up and it's going to update in this kind of rich HTML output showing us what's being found. And you can see that hosts are starting to pop up in our interface, right? Pretty cool. And we're just going to let that run. Thankfully, the fast option is decently fast. The communication channel for the core agent makes a big difference here, by the way. It makes a really big difference. And so because we are using a reverse TCP connection, that's going to make things very performant for us. So that's pretty nice. And again, you can see that just hosts are starting to pop up in our interface as everything goes. And I've come over to module log, you can see kind of like some of what's going on. And what is nice, what's very powerful here, is we could be chained like three levels deep, four levels deep, and be doing the same thing, because that's the power of Impact. Set a source and you're there. Everything in this tool set is done through the agent. And the other thing I want to point out while this is going, and just to kind of talk through it, when I started playing around with Core Impact, I really stumbled with this tool set. And there were a lot of things in the tool set that I didn't find intuitive because I just didn't understand that philosophy. Like I was confused when I would run a module and I was getting the save dialog that took a moment to come up. I didn't realize, oh, it's because my source agent that I'm like pivoted in deep with is actually the one populating that save dialog. But I think once you kind of understand this idea that once you set an agent as source, it's almost like you're teleporting yourself to controlling that agent directly, then the power of this tool set and the power of its abstractions kind of becomes clear. So that's a lot of fun. And so, you know, it's been a lot of fun seeing another tool set and seeing how it works. So the network information gathering wizard's going, and you can kind of see that even for individual hosts, we've discovered they each have their own little progress bar to kind of give us an idea of what's going on with these systems. You know, like how much longer do we have to go to find out what we're going to find out about that particular system? So that's pretty neat. I'm going to let that go because I want to kind of jump into another part of the demo, and that is I'd mentioned PowerShell. I'd mentioned that we can import scripts, and I just want to show you what that looks like. So we're going to, on agent zero here, we are going to open up a PowerShell shell. And we are going to, and it's going to take a moment because we've got a lot of work going through this agent already with the network information gathering. So that's why you're going to see a little bit of latency, some things. But what we're going to do is remember that pound help. This is the things we can do through that are impact specific commands. And we're just going to do import file, C users user, that's what I am, desktop, PowerSploit, recon, powerview.ps1. And that's going to import PowerView into this particular PowerShell shell. And we're going to use one of my favorite commands. As you'll recall, I am the user Jim Stevens, right, on the domain corp. And one of my favorite PowerShell commandlets in PowerView is find local admin access, which is just going to sweep the network, try to connect to an admin-only share, and give us an idea of which systems we might be able to target as the user Jim Stevens, because Jim Stevens can administer it, and you can see fileserver.corp.acme.com. Pretty cool, pretty handy. All right, let's go ahead and take a look at lateral movement with Core Impact. And again, we're still sourced to agent zero over here, okay? So, you know, we're still doing things through this agent. And we're going to target the file server, right? Let me show you how to do this. We're going to come over to modules. And really, the stuff we have for lateral movement has the flavor install agent using. These are our lateral movement modules. And again, this is not a Windows-specific toolkit. So you have install agent using SSH, which is a credentialed entry point to getting something onto a Unix target. And we'll take a look at that. But let's do install agent using SMB. So we're just going to drag down to the file server. And again, what is different is because we're relaying everything through the agent, but we're not using Windows APIs for the lateral movement. We're using MPacket. We do have to give it an explicit identity. But remember, we are able to recover that password hash, and we can use that. So this is pretty handy. So let's go ahead and just pick the identity for Jim Stevens. Or actually, that's the Kerberos ticket. Let's grab the NTLM hash. Hit OK. And you can see that that's actually configured. We've got file server as our target. I'm comfortable with this. One thing I should point out, it's the same thing when we did the UAC bypass, but the default for a lot of these modules is going to be connect from target, which is actually going to go through our selected source agent, or connect to target, which is a bind agent. But when I did do the UAC bypass, what I want you to be aware of is that we did chain the agents together, and we are actually, agent one is actually chained through agent zero, and I'll actually show you how you can see that in a moment. So let's hit OK. But we are going to do install agent using SMB, again, that whole PS exec thing. If we look at the module log, we can see what's going on. It's trying to use the share admin dollar. It is going to generate a executable, you know, kind of using the same stuff in package and register agent. And then it will interact with the target, and it will hopefully give us an access. That is the goal. And you can see it's uploading the file. And again, appreciate that there's some latency because we are pushing a pretty intense information gathering process through the same agent right now. But you can see that the exploit was successful. And you know, we've got that information. And then we've got a new agent was deployed, and you can see if we click on the plus, yes, indeed, there's our agent two with a little flash, right? Now, earlier I mentioned, let's do Mimikatz. I always run Mimikatz, it's just how I roll. Earlier I mentioned that with impact, I mentioned that we can see, you know, we are chaining agents together. Trust me, I would love an Armitage like Armitage or Cobalt Strike like graph view here. I think that would make a lot of sense. It'd be pretty cool. But we do have a module to show you the chain for an agent, and that's show agent chaining route. And so if I just kind of drag that onto agent two, hit OK, what you will see is that we're going from local agent to agent zero to agent two. So that's how you can kind of see that. Same thing for agent one. We'll just run that. And I just want you to see that local agent to agent zero to agent one, that's the communication path. Again, pivoting is very, very, very natural in this tool set. And we can see our Mimikatz modules running. And again, we are kind of gathering just a bunch of things here from the system, but it's gonna take a moment because again, we are pushing through this pretty intense network information gathering process as well. So pretty neat, all that's still going. Let me show you something else that I think is pretty cool, and that's going to be, let me show you control of a Unix target using Impact. So we're gonna target 10.10.10.21, which with just credentials. So I'm gonna show you just install agent using SSH. And by the way, if you do have access to a Unix system and you wanna drop an agent on it, you can. Use package and register agent and generate an ELF binary. But for now, we're just going to do install agent using SSH. I'll just put in the credentials that I happen to know. And for agent connection, you can tell it to spawn its own connection, or you can just reuse the SSH connection, have the agent traffic right over that SSH connection. And that's what we're going to choose here. So let's go ahead and let that run. And I've got the new agent deployed. You can see the little plus, and there's our agent three. All right. So let's go ahead and just right click. Notice we can set this agent as source and actually start doing lateral movement and everything else through this agent. Or we can start catching shells and other things through this particular agent. All right. So same kind of stuff. What I want to show you, and also all the PCAP stuff, you can install a PCAP plugin as well here. First thing I'll show you, we do have the file browser. Give that a moment to come up. Yeah, that's the beauty of shoving this network reconnaissance tool through at the same time. Let me just kind of collapse some of these trees so we keep track of what's going on. But let me pull up my file browser, and here you go. We've got the file browser on our Linux system, so we can kind of just navigate around. All right, so let's go to the home folder. Let's just double click on home, user, and here's all of our stuff for our user. Pretty fun. And here's my favorite part. Right click, shell, and we have a shell, right? We can run commands on the target, right? Check this out. It's a full TTY. You can do everything through this shell. Let's see here. I've been so used to Windows, I keep doing fine string and quoting everything instead of grep. Holy cow. But let me just show you. You can see our connection to 10.10.10.21, us, port 22, through 10.10.10.191, and that's agent zero, right? That's our source agent, our original source agent. And what's also nice here, of course, is, you know, I'm just kind of being a little bit lazy, and yeah, I can just do sudo without any guff. And that's nice because, you know, I should be able to. And that's nice. We have a full interactive TTY here. And this fits into that philosophy in Core Impact, which is to make you feel like you're sitting in front of the computer and just giving you the ability to do things to it. That's what we're trying to do with this tool set. And so that's the Unix post-exploitation. Pretty cool. And again, remember, You can set this as source and start pivoting and discovering other targets and launching exploits and doing everything, including targeting Windows systems from this particular agent as your pivot point. Let me check on our information gathering, which, oh my God, I think it might be done, which is awesome. Our network information gathering looks complete. That's great. I think we're in a great spot to show you kind of just another impact workflow, and that is launching exploits. And I want to show you that because, you know, this is like exploits are part of the identity of this tool. It's just something we have and do in this product. So let me show you what that looks like. And to kind of demo that, we're going to target Metasploitable 2, which is a very old virtual machine, very, very many, many vulnerabilities. It was published by the Metasploit project. But I think it's great just to kind of get a feel for what it looks like to launch exploits from Impact. And so we're just going to do the RPT over here. We're going to do attack and penetration. We'll just drag that right onto that particular host. Hit next. We'll just do that target. And we will just fire away. And actually, we're just going to let it keep going. And you can actually configure some advanced criteria for the exploits. I don't really care. I'm just going to hit finish. And we're going to let Impact fire away. Keep in mind, our pivot point is an unprivileged Windows agent here. Oops, we just got our first access, looks like. Agent number 4. And if we look at our network and penetration testing, we can see attack results that the Unreal IRCD backdoor picked up. And so we just got our second one. I keep hearing new agent deployed through my headphones. And you'll see that this will refresh. We've got the DCC remote code execution exploit. And you know, this is going to run. It's going to pick up what it does. And my main point in showing you this is how Impact works. This is stuff you can do with Impact. So that's what that automation looks like. And again, you know, in certain like kinds of contexts, I can see firing off a bunch of modules, seeing what I get, being very valuable. I can see that when I am in a context where there is a new interest exploit, like the F5 Big IP one, or the Exchange exploit from this year, or SMB Ghost, I think it's pretty nice to be able to jump over into Impact and use Impact for its strengths, use it for its modules, and then kind of get back to either doing things through Impact or jumping back to another tool. There you go, we just got another access. Agent 6, I wonder what that one was. Let's click over here. And yeah, this is the Samba user map one. Again, pretty old vulnerabilities, but just for demonstrating the workflow, I think this is Metasploitable is a great exemplar for doing that. And you can download that VM and try it out yourself. So with that, I'm kind of taking you through a bit of an introduction to Core Impact. And what I've done here, and just to kind of re-foot stomp, is I really wanted to take you through how to search the module tree, how to think about post-exploitation and what we give you for post-exploitation. And I wanted to really show you those entry points into the tool. For example, serve agent and web server. And I wanted to show you package and register agent, which we're going to use in the Cobalt Strike Core Impact interoperability videos. And the lateral movement options, which are install agent using whatever. I think they're really important. And it's nice to have these and to be able to just run them from the context of an agent without having to elevate. If you happen to have the credential material that you want to use, because this offense model allows that. But it's also nice that you've got this whole collection of exploits that you can bring to bear and this very intuitive pivoting model of being able to chain whatever you want to catch and whatever you want to fire through any of your agents. And I think it's very powerful that you've got a very simple but very usable post-exploitation interface. And I think it's especially relevant with the Unix targets. As I think we're working with Unix targets, I think that's a place where we're hurting. Like I think, I know that that's the number one feature request I get in Cobalt Strike. Raph, when are you adding a Unix beacon? Well, go use Core Impact. We have the Impact agent and we've got it for a bunch of different platforms. You can export something and run it and start doing your post-exploitation. So that's my demonstration of Core Impact. I hope you've enjoyed it. I've definitely enjoyed going through all this material with you. Good luck and happy hacking.